Hey, this is Mike Lewis from Awareness Inc., and I'd like to welcome everybody to our session today. I'm really excited about it. I've actually been excited about this one since we scheduled it a while ago. If you haven't had a chance to read the book, Six Pixels of Separation, you're going to get the thumbnail version of it now from Mitch Joel, the author and president of Swiss Image. But before I introduce Mitch, I wanted to quickly go through a couple slides in just about awareness. One of the things that always seems to happen after our webinars is people come on and they learn a lot, and then they come back and ask me questions after, with really simple questions like, who is awareness and what is it that you guys really do? So I thought this time we get to kind of just walk through really two or three slides up front, give you a sense of who we are, and then just turn the presenter ball over to Mitch and jump into Six Pixels of Separation. And by the way, for Tamsin, I just saw your tweet, and I am also glad that this is a webinar, so you don't get anybody sick. So glad that you're able to join us from home. Real quick, if you have any questions throughout the session, feel free to jump on and chat with us on Twitter. I know Twitter's been kind of up and down all day, so for anybody that's out there that can get access to Twitter, shoot us any of your questions using the hashtag #PoundAwarenessInc. And also, if you're don't have access to Twitter, or if you get the fail whale, feel free to use the Q&A button, or the Q&A tab, I should say, which is located in the lower right-hand corner of the WebEx client that you're all looking at right now. One other note, if you have any technical issues during the call, you can use the Q&A button to chat with the people from WebEx directly. You can also use the chat feature to get in touch with the people from WebEx, or use the help tab in the upper right of the client that you're working with. So. But again, we appreciate you having on the call. Real quickly about awareness, we've been around for a while. We have a platform that allows organizations to build online communities in a nutshell. And we work with some really large brands, companies like McDonald's, Kodak, Marriott, Sony, Discovery Channel, JetBlue, list goes on and on of organizations that we work with to help power their online presence, typically around their marketing campaigns, but we also have communities that support customer support and innovation and things along those lines, which I'll talk about in a minute. One other thing, I know there are a lot of advertising agencies online. This is a quick scan of the list. And for those of you that don't know or would like to learn a little bit more about how we work with agencies, we work with a ton of ad agencies helping them roll out communities for their customers. And really, it's simple. If you think about the math behind how we work with agencies, awareness provides the technology, partner provides the services, they go out and create the campaigns, all the creative stuff that goes into creating a successful social media campaign, and at the end, it's the customer who ends up being successful. So, like I said, we work with a lot of agencies. If you're interested in learning more about it, feel free to give me a buzz or drop me a DM on Twitter, and we'll get things moving. Just real quickly about our product. At the end of the day, awareness is a technology suite. We sell software. We have a set of 8 best practice communities that sit on top of our platform, which we've invested a lot of time, a lot of effort, and a lot of money into building. And essentially these 8 best practice communities, which is what we call them, are really cool because they're based on use cases. One of the big problems that a lot of people getting into social media have is they say, well, you're the experts, you know, get me started, what do I need to think about in terms of social media? Well, what we've done is look at our history, look at the clients that we've worked with, and we've built communities that are prepackaged, we're ready to deploy, we're ready to make them look and feel like your organization, and they're focused on specific use cases. And what's really cool about them is we're actually tracking specific metrics that are associated with each BPC, best practice community, that gauge whether or not you're successful. So, for example, for a peer support community, we're measuring number of closed support requests, for example, and factoring in a cost of your typical support request so you can actually see how much money you're saving on a weekly, monthly, quarterly, or annual basis. A little different when you get into things like the corporate voice community, we're tracking different metrics where you might want to look at the number of members and what the cost of generating a new lead, quote-unquote, would be, or how many page views you're getting, you know, that kind of stuff. It's unique for each BPC, and again, based on use case, which is really cool. And just to break these out even more, these are some of the customers that we're working with as you start to look at the BPCs that we're getting into and just, you know, working with, like I said, a whole bunch of different customers and a whole range of different use cases that really make it, you know, help us gauge whether or not a customer is successful and what they're doing with social media. So, again, if you have any questions about any of this stuff and you're interested in learning more, feel free to drop me a DM on Twitter and we can chat about it in some more detail. So, like I said, with that, I was going to keep the sales pitch to an absolute minimum, and that's really all I have. And with that, I'm going to change the presenter here, and it's going to go over to Mitch, who's going to talk about 6 pixels of separation. Now, before I Mitch, before you get started, just a real quick intro for those of you that don't know Mitch. Mitch is the president of Twist Image, and that's a digital marketing communications agency, and it's based up in Canada. And what's great about that is Awareness, my company, is also founded up in Canada. So really cool stuff coming out of Canada. He's been called a marketing communications visionary, interactive expert, community leader. He's an avid blogger, podcaster, entrepreneur, and speaker who enjoys connecting with people online. And yeah, I'm really excited to have Mitch on the line. Like I said, if you haven't read his book yet, it's terrific, one of my favorites, and can't recommend it enough. So, Mitch, welcome, and thanks for joining us today.
Thanks so much for having me. So I just want to make sure my slides are up and everything's sounding good.
Everything sounds great. The slides look good.
So now it's only up to me to make this work. Thanks so much, Mike, and everyone at Awareness. I really appreciate it. And thanks to you for joining in. I'm also a big fan of doing webinars because that means I don't have to have my bum in an airplane, so which is kind of nice to sit here and chat with you all. So thanks so much for taking part in this. One of the things that I've sort of recognized in my life is that when I get the opportunity to get up and talk about the digital landscape, and I guess more specifically social media, I sort of have this weird, I guess it's a weird look if you don't know me. It's not so weird to me, but I'm bald, I'm tall, and I dress mostly in black. And when I stand up on stage, I think people look at me like, this guy's going to talk to me about the future or show me where the world is going. And the truth is, I've really learned, I think, in the past 2 years that talking about where things are going is futile only because, not because we can't read the future or anything, you know, sort of basic like that, but just because I think there's so many things happening now that have fundamentally shifted the way in which business works that the focus really needs to be on the present. And so what I'm going to hopefully do in the next little while is spend some time with you all talking about where I believe the world is at and the implications it has on business, and I'm hoping that it sparks some really creative ideas within you that gets you thinking about ways in which you can improve your business from a whole level of ways. Before I talk about the future, though, I want to talk a little bit about the past. And you're seeing a photo of a very controversial figure, and I sort of always hesitate to put Cortez's picture up there because, you know, I think we now know, or we sort of have the levity to realize that these sort of great discoveries of people to the new world, there were people already here in this new world, and the sort of damage was done there. And you know, there's sort of two sides to every story, sometimes three or four. But he is an interesting character because he is widely regarded as the individual that eventually conquered Mexico, as if, you know, Mexico was sitting around waiting to be conquered. But a lot of gold and the Mayans and all that sort of stuff. And there is one sort of thing we know about this very interesting moment in history, which is that these moments were really glamorized in movies and TV movie series and stuff like that. You know, when you think of a Cortez or a Columbus, you sort of have this vision in your mind of these big boats, big white masts, you know, coming up to these virgin territories of big wavy grass and natives and stuff like that. And the truth is that those times were, as we really know, if you study history, quite brutal. In fact, if you just look at those journeys to get over here, you know, people died on those journeys. These crews were not in the best shape at all. They were lacking some very primitive technology that you and I all take for granted, things like air conditioning, GPS systems, stuff like that. And in that sort of moment, too, there's stress. You know, I mean, I think we sort of fly East Coast, West Coast across the Atlantic to Europe and think, oh, you know, my seat didn't recline and my movie didn't work. What a bad flight that was. You know, you got to remember, people died on these journeys. You know, it wasn't quite as bad as the seat not reclining or not being any place to sort of watch a movie. That being said, the crew's making their way up to what is Mexico. A couple of them move forward to Cortez and say, what's the plan? How long are we going to be here for? What's our plan to go back? And Cortez does something extremely dramatic where he burns the ships. More legend than fact if you really dig a little deep, but there's still a story here, like, you know, no going back, only going forward. I heard this story for the first time in about 2002, and it really struck me. At the time, I was the president and still, you know, one of the founders of Twist Image, a digital marketing agency, where we were, you know, at the time, we were three business partners and one employee in a very, very small office. And looking at the space and thinking, all of this new technology, all of the things that the internet is able to do, and this was in 2002, keep in mind, you know, blogging was just really coming around at that point. And I was sort of shocked that the type of marketing and communications that we're doing, very traditional. There was really nothing new. I mean, if you look at banner ads, they were like billboards or ads in magazines. If you look at email marketing even, really all you were looking at is direct marketing in the digital channel. When I started really digging deep and thinking about how different internet was when you compare it to TV, print, media, whatever it might have been, traditional media, whatever it might have been, I realized that we really hadn't grown the ships. We were just, you know, it was the old way of doing things, old rules, old ways. And so how do you burn the ships and how do we move forward? And that's sort of the spark that I think has led to the growth of my agency. We're now at about 90-plus people with offices in both Toronto and Montreal. The blog, the podcast, all that stuff. Really is about how do we burn those ships. And so what I've done is I've actually modernized the story for all of you. And what I'm hoping happens in the next little while that we spend together is you Control-Alt-Delete. You know, you really rethink the way you're doing your marketing and communications, specifically because of this internet channel and social media and all these things that are taking place. And so my real hopes by the end of the session is that you'll take some notes, not of the stuff I'm going to talk about, but of what's happening in your business and how you can rethink. Because I do believe that if I were to pull any one of you into a room and sit down and grab a coffee with you and say, okay, forget your job, let's just go on and you're going to start a new business, and you tell me what it is, whatever you're passionate about. And I said, okay, well, how would you market this? How would you communicate this? How would you advertise it? My guess is it would be dramatically different from the way in which we're conducting ourselves professionally in our day-to-day jobs as marketers or agency people and stuff like that. And so that's really what this is about. And so I'm going to refer back to the idea of, you know, burning the ships and control all the lead, but that's what I'm really hoping you guys can take care of that. And it's not just that the traditional channels don't work. You know, this stat came out this past week. I mean, this is crazy. We're seeing a minus 50% in clicks on banner ads since 2007. I mean, so it's not even like, oh, since the old days when people were clicking on, and this is pretty recent. You've got some pretty advanced consumers by 2007, and clicking on ads is just sort of dropping off. So it's not about, you know, the conversation we're going to have today about 6 pixels of separation isn't just about what's happening in traditional media as opposed to new media. It's also to demonstrate that even in new media, the stuff we're doing isn't all that effective. It's just not working the way we thought it could be. Now, there's a power here in terms of branding and all that, and I get that, and we can definitely have a conversation about that for sure. But in general, what we're seeing is a huge drop here. Now, if that didn't make you throw up a little bit in your mouth, what probably will is that if you look at the internet population, we're talking somewhere around 1.5 billion people now. This statistic is also aligned with another interesting statistic, and that additional statistic is this. All of those ads that are being clicked on by the other 50%, only 8% of all internet users account for that 50%. 8%. So 8% of all internet users are actually the ones clicking on ads. So, you know, we definitely see the inefficiency of the idea of banners that people click on, and sort of the numbers are true there. So basically, we don't have a lot of time, so I want to walk you through three things that I hope are going to be helpful for you and hopefully going to change your business as well. One is I'm going to walk us a bit through how we got here. Two will be some awesomely mind-blowing stats, so now I've got to live up to that statement. Let's see if I can do that. And then three will be quick wins, just things I think many businesses can start doing right away. Before I get into it, though, I want to be very, very clear. Doing all of our research and also running an agency the size that we have, I am talking B2C. I am talking B2B as well. I'm talking impulse buys, things that you would pick up in the store for a buck, and I am talking about products that you sell on a multi-year sales cycle that cost millions of dollars. We have seen, again, statistically in our own research and our own work here, that it doesn't matter which segment you're in, public-facing, business-facing, small margins, high margins, that this stuff works, that there's a whole bunch of stuff happening within these systems, and that, this stuff is all good, basically, is how we're looking at it. So, again, let's talk a little bit about the reality check. We're not going to talk about the future at all. We're going to really look at where we are in the present and how things are. We all know what this device is, obviously, right? It's the iPhone. Everyone has seen one. I have one of those interestingly charmed lives where once in a while someone in my family will invariably walk up to me and say something like, what do you do for a living again? They don't understand the world of a digital marketing individual. So they're like, you get paid money to build Facebook pages and videos for YouTube and websites? Yeah, and talk about it too, it appears. So pretty sort of interesting lifestyle I have. And then one day we were having a brunch at our house, and one of my wife's friends comes over to me and he shows me the iPhone and goes, have you seen this? And I said, but the first thing in my brain is like, does nobody here really know what I do for a living? Unbelievable, right? And obviously he's like, no, I know you know what an iPhone is, but have you seen this application called Snaptel? So Snaptel is a really interesting app, and at that point in time, I actually had not seen it. One of those people that I used a BlackBerry, and I got an iPod Touch, and I'm slowly going to make the transition, I think, in the coming weeks to an iPhone 3GS and see how I can do with both devices and then hopefully just one. And so he fires up this Snaptel application, takes a look around my house, sees the coffee table with some books on it, takes a picture of one of the books. Immediately, the picture of the book comes up on the screen, so this technology was able to recognize what was in the photograph and turn it into an actual piece of data. Book comes up, shows me all the prices that you can get it for online. It shows me all of the major reviews for it, New York Times, Wall Street Journal, USA Today. At the same time, it shows me all the reviews that we've all written. We've all submitted things to places like Amazon, Yelp, Canada, maybe Indigo Chapters, Barnes & Noble, you name it, they're all there. The amazing thing about the iPhone, that's pretty amazing in one instance, but the real amazing thing about it from my side is, too, it's one of the altimeter. In fact, when you move it, it sort of rotates and does all this cool stuff. And the second part is obviously the GPS capabilities of it. And so what happened next was also pretty cool, where it was showing me how physically close I was to being able to buy this object, but I didn't want to buy it online, meaning at a physical store, literally with directions to the store to get it. And you sort of have that moment where you realize you think you're holding the future, but it's really the present. I mean, this stuff exists. I mean, imagine how dramatically these types of applications are changing and will continue to change business as we know it. Imagine walking into a Best Buy, taking a picture of a Blu-ray DVD player, turning to the manager and saying, listen, I can get this for $60 less down the street. Does that change everything we know about business? I mean, unequivocally, of course, it changes everything we know. Imagine if the thing has a terrible review, and you turn to the manager and go, this is Best Buy. I thought you guys were better than this. Like, what are you carrying this piece of junk for? And so we are in this very strange world where consumers are so dramatically empowered, and these tools exist, and they go beyond just basic research and all that stuff. They really are impacting the way we are as human beings. What you're seeing on the screen is the screen grab I took off the internet. This is augmented reality. So if it didn't freak you out that you could use your iPhone to take a picture and have it recognize it and give you all this information, augmented reality will be the deal closer for you. This is just a demo shot of a screen grabbed off of Google Images, but basically what you're seeing is augmented reality. You open up your iPhone 3GS, which has video functionality, you turn on this application, and in this instance, you're able to see how close and how far certain buildings might be. In this case, it's a real estate, so you can see underneath it what the grade is, how much it costs, who to contact, et cetera, et cetera. So suddenly reality gets augmented through our connectivity and stuff like that. And it goes even further. If you use Yelp on your iPhone, you know about this application where you just point it in front of restaurants, hotels. It'll give you the ratings, what it is. You can dig down deeper for more information. So, you know, you talk about the empowered consumer. We've never been this empowered before, and it's changing everything we know about business and connectivity. You stopped right there. This is probably some of the stuff that you're going, yeah, cool. Because if you're on the webinar, you probably already know that this stuff exists, and you're like, I love this stuff, and I'm trying to get my clients to do it. But the reality is that when clients see this sort of stuff, they freak out. And they start saying things like, you know, we're no longer in control of our brand. What are we going to do? How are we going to do this? Clearly, if consumers have access to this type of content and information, we have to get a whole lot better at how we communicate with them, and we don't know if we can get that much better. And on top of that, obviously, advertising can't work anymore. And that's the big thing here, too, is that people feel that traditional advertising is just simply not as effective anymore because of these many new online channels and conversations that are taking place. Another sort of photo that I grabbed off the web. Maybe they're wrong. You know, when I was growing up, one of my favorite TV shows was Sesame Street. I used to love that song, One of These Things Doesn't Belong. In this instance, I don't know that it's actually true. I don't know if we could sing the song for this. And yeah, you're all seeing what I'm seeing, that glowing, beautiful white apple. I'm here to tell you that as immune as people think that consumers are to advertising and that as immune as they are to it because of these new media channels, it's simply not the case. We live in the most branded generation ever. And I'm not just talking about young kids in university, because that's typically where the more mature marketers look. Oh, it's just young people that are doing it. No, we all are. We are all engaged and connected to brands in ways in which we have never been before in the history of civilization. And again, that has huge implications on how we run business and how we do things. And so my whole sort of thought here is, if you can understand that making people connect to your brand is important and where to connect to them, you really can win, and that there isn't a real brand or advertising immunity at all. In fact, we're more open to this than ever before. I was recently, I was about to say recently, it wasn't so recently, but it was definitely under a couple of years, heading over to Europe to do a speaking event. And I picked up a copy of Business Week before it was Bloomberg Business Week, I guess. And they had a cover story on social media, so I was all excited, as I normally get when I see cool cover stories like that. And within that, they had a one-on-one conversation, which they do in every issue of Business Week, where they have a conversation with the CEO. It's pretty much Q&A standard stuff, but always interesting, always fascinating. And in this instance, it was one with Chris DeWolf. Now, some of you may recognize Chris DeWolf's name. At the time, he was the CEO of MySpace, owned by News Corp. We'll see if that continues on as the years progress. Currently, Chris is no longer with the company. He's been stepped aside. They're sort of going through a whole bunch of their own issues, I guess, now for following the news on that. But in the interview, there was this fascinating stat that I want to share with you, where he said that 40% of mothers in the U.S. are on MySpace. And it really threw me for a loop, because he didn't say 40% of mothers who are moms who are online are on MySpace. It's 40% of all mothers. Now, thankfully, I think it was Sarah Lacey, who was the journalist, pushed him a little further, and he said, well, you know, if you think about it, the Internet was commercialized 10, 15 years ago, and these women were 17, 18, 19. Fast forward 10, 15 years, yeah, they're moms, but they're still interested in connecting to their friends. They're still interested in music, literature, movies. They definitely want to creep on what their kids are doing, so there's that aspect of it as well. But they're connected. And the reason I'm sharing this with you is because all too often people sort of segment and fragment based off of what they think. And one of those assumptions with MySpace was, you know, it's a bunch of kids in long trench coats or, you know, dark eyeliner and sitting in the basement listening to Fall Out Boys, and, you know, once in a while the parents throw peanuts downstairs when they grunt and stuff. And it's simply not the case. With 1.5 plus billion people online now, the demographics and psychographics of a lot of these tools that you and I are really psyched about and get excited about really are representative of the whole world. And it's just more a question of figuring out, you know, which one fits best for your audience versus whether or not it even makes sense for you to be there, because we are seeing nice and rich segments within all of these platforms as well. July 7th of 2009, which was like yesterday, Read What Right Web was reporting that there are more grandparents than high school students on Facebook. And if you sort of, again, embrace that idea of what's going on here, one of the first thoughts should be around the idea of why movies open, why kids' movies actually open so big. Right, Where the Wild Things Are opened at number one in the U.S. and Canada this past week. From all intents and purposes, it shouldn't have. It didn't get great reviews. There was nobody there extolling the virtues of this movie at all. You've got to understand that, you know, when you go to a kid's movie, it's not one ticket, right? You usually have the kid who buys the ticket, or the parent buys it with their kid. Also, the kid's got to bring a friend. The parent's got to go with them, and then the parent has to bring someone else along with them to endure the torture of some of these movies. And so, you know, for every one ticket you sell, you're looking really at four tickets. And this is really why, you know, kids' events, movies, et cetera, scale so fast. And so if you think about it in this instance, it makes sense. You know, a lot of kids in high school still have all four grandparents. I've met people who said they have six to eight grandparents as well. Do the math on the sort of new ways that we have new families now. And, yeah, they're interested in knowing what their kids are doing on Facebook. They keep reading about it in places like USA Today and CNN, and they want to make sure that their grandkids aren't drunk or naked on Facebook. So they're essentially creeping on these kids, and you have this sudden uptick in grandparents joining onto these online social networks. But there's something different happening here, too, which is, you know, grandma goes on, she's creeping on my profile, make sure I'm being a good boy, and then all of a sudden she notices on the right people you should be connected to, and she realizes that, oh, look, there's Sarah. Sarah and I went to high school 60 years ago together. I haven't seen her in forever, and they connect. And you know how it is. Next thing you know, grandma is adding friends, adding family members, uploading pictures, sharing things, and just down the rabbit hole they go. And so their reason for joining was a lot different than what we might think, but nevertheless, they join, they're active, and they're participating in this conversation, and suddenly there's a valuable segment of people on this that we didn't know. I mean, ultimately, you guys know all this. You know that it's no longer all about idly surfing or passively reading or listening or watching TV. It's about doing stuff. I mean, if you guys have a Facebook profile, you can feel free to add me as a friend if you want at the end of this. I'll tell you, candidly, the only person I've ever ignored was a request from my mother, so you're pretty safe if you want to connect to me. And you're also safe with her freaking on your profile. But you know this, right? Other than the most fun thing, which is indeed creeping on other people's pictures and seeing what they were up to, it's the creational aspect of this media channel that really changes the game. It's the fact that you're engaged, you're doing stuff, you're pushing things forward. Some of my volunteer work involves associations like the Canadian Marketing Association and the Interactive Advertising Bureau. And one of the things I get to see as a board member involved in both of those associations is research and stuff like that. And, you know, listen, we're constantly battling to get interactive more on the map here. And it's crazy if you think about it that, you know, interactive on a good day will account for 10% of all of the online advertising budget. It's crazy that it's only that. But that's the reality of it. And so we're constantly doing this research to figure out what's going on. I mean, in a world where internet usage is having a hockey stick-like growth curve, TV gets stagnant, radio drops, print drops, why is it that the ad dollars aren't falling? And so in one of these instances in reports that I was reviewing, they were actually asking people, while watching TV, what other things are you doing? And I was shocked to find out, and I was shocked or surprised, that 40% of people said while watching TV, they're doing what? Blank. And so, you know, obviously we're on a call like this, and the answer is they're on their laptops, they're on their mobile device, they're surfing the web, they're listening to their iPod. But wrong, 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 and wrong, that wasn't it, actually. 40% of people said while watching TV, they're actually sleeping. They're asleep when TV's going on. And so if you go back to that old John Wanamaker quote that half of my advertising works, I just don't know which half, and you layer onto this the fact that 40% of people are admitting it, by the way, are sleeping when those ads are running, what does that tell you? As a new media guy, you're probably like, I get what Mitch is doing. He's trying to shift our mindset away from traditional mass media over to new media, and that's absolutely not the case at all. The research went a little deeper. Here's what's going on. When consumers are no longer engaged in creating and they're no longer passive, they're awake. But when they move and shift into these more passive media channels, like reading, listening, watching only, and they're not actually initiating with their hands or their fingers or whatever it might be, brains are shutting down. We're physiologically changing. And so when people say to me, you get really hyped up about new media and what it means, and you seem overly excited about it, and you say it's going to change business as we know it, it's actually not true. We actually know that new media is changing people physiologically. It's actually changing how we are as people. That changes who we are as a society and civilization. And you know what? The smaller ramifications of it, which are huge to you and I, is that it's changing business as well. And so it's a lot bigger than just saying, well, it's changing business as we know it. The other amazing thing is how we are online. This trust economy. Brilliant, great book about this, Trust Agents by Julian Smith and Chris Brogan. If you're not following those guys, Chris Brogan and Julian Smith are well worth following. And a great book, Trust Agents. Check it out. We trust each other online in ways in which that are dramatically different from how we used to do it. I mean, if you think about it, it's crazy. Look at my book, for instance, 6 Pixels of Separation. My book is published by Grand Central Publishing, which are the same people who do, you know, John Stewart, Stephen Colbert, Jack Welch, Donald Trump. Owned by Hachette. Hachette is also responsible for Gladwell and Stephen Myers and the Twilight series. Well, the publisher has been in business 300 years. Literally 300 years. I'm not even making that up. They've been publishing bestsellers year on year. It's what they do. And it's amazing that as consumers, we go onto places like Barnes & Noble's 800 CEO Read Amazon, and we read reviews of strangers, right? Sally in Chicago, Illinois, she must have a better opinion than Hachette, who signed this actual offer. It's amazing. So we actually have this implicit trust or this wisdom of crowds working that is very, very unique. And you probably know this, where no one really buys online without at least first checking out consumer reviews. Now, if you ask brands, why don't you have consumer reviews, or as I call them, peer reviews on your site, the first answer, doesn't matter if an industry, business, consumer, is always the same. The answer goes right back to, we're afraid of what people will say about us. which I always love, because what it really implies is our products and services may not be so good, we don't want people to talk about it, which is crazy. But I do believe in 2009, most products and services are actually quite good. I believe some of them have faults and issues along the way for certain individuals, but overall, products and services are quite good. But still, that's just for common fears. Like, what if people say bad things about us? And so one of my good friends is Brett. Brett is the owner of an amazing company called Bizarre Voice out of Austin, Texas. And Brett's an interesting guy. He's a bit of a prodigy because Brett was the founder of CoreMetrics, the web analytics tool, and then sort of got moved over from that into Bizarre Voice. And Bizarre Voice offers a whole bunch of social media type stuff. But one of the things they have is third-party peer review auditing. So what they're essentially doing is on all of these sites that offer peer reviews is they're auditing them. Why? Well, consumer comes to the site and sees these peer reviews. Consumer needs to know that these peer reviews are written by a real human being. That it's not an employee of a company, it's not someone who's paid to write them, it's not the PR company, it's a real person. The second reason they're there is for just general semantic stuff like checking for language, you know, swear words, religious content. Sometimes people are sensitive to that, and so they want to make sure that that's not there as well. Over the years, this company's grown quite well, and they've served, I think, to date, somewhere over 10 billion peer reviews, which I believe to be a very fair sample size of what's happening in the marketplace. Now, if I were to ask you out of a 5-star rating, what is the average in 10 billion, you can go dramatically on the right or left, and it doesn't matter. When it's 10 billion, you're usually going to see a number right smack in the middle, 2.5, 3, 3.5. Now, here's something pretty staggering. The average rating, 10 billion reviews, is 4.3 plus out of 5. We actually know statistically that people don't say bad things. They say actually nice things. It's the total opposite of what we think. And so there's one of the sort of more, I think, mind-blowing stats for sure. But here's one that really shocked me. Brett told me, and I'll share it with you. A negative review converts more effectively to a sale than a positive review. I'll repeat that. A negative review converts more effectively to a sale than a positive review. How is that even possible? As new media and hip as I think I might be, that is way off my charts of recognition. Now, what's interesting here is a couple things are happening. One, trust. Consumer comes to the site, sees a negative review, and goes, you know what? If this brand is willing to put that up there, they're pretty cool and I'm going to buy from them. So they sort of move on and find what they want. But more interestingly, it's actually not that. It's the semantics of it. And here are the semantics of it. Just had a kid and we're looking to buy a point-and-shoot camera, one that my wife can just toss into her purse, one that I can just keep around. Easy peasy, nice and easy. So I choose the camera I want and I wind up going to see a whole bunch of reviews. And the first review that comes up is actually contrary to the 10 billion plus we just talked about. It's a 1 out of 5. And I go to read the review, and the review says something like, I've been a professional photographer for 5 years. This camera has very limited manual functionality. In fact, it claims to have a 12 times autofocus, when in reality it's only, you know, 11.2, whatever it might be. Camera's probably only good if all you want to do is take pictures of your family. And I'm sitting there going, that's exactly why I'm looking to buy this. All I'm looking to do is take pictures of my family. You probably had instances like this as well. You're on TripAdvisor looking to get a cheap hotel in New York City, $150. You read a review, it's a negative review, and it says something like, hotel's very clean, very quiet, but when I came back to my hotel room at 6 p.m., my bed wasn't turned. There was no chocolates on the pillow. The TV only has 15 channels versus 80 at the other hotel I stayed in. You're like, I don't care. Cheap hotel, $150, clean, quiet, perfect, check, check, off I go. There's a semantic nature to this. And I want us all to embrace this, that sometimes a negative review is actually works in our favor to convert to a sale. And that's really what's going on here, which I find so interesting. The other thing is that marketing and advertising, from back in the early days of it, always promised to offer a real interaction between a real human being. And that was really the fundamental promise of great advertising. Maybe not so much in the Mad Men era, but just before that potentially. If you think about that as a core value, that's really why I get extremely passionate about these new digital channels and social media in particular. Finally, you can really have a real interaction between real people. And that's a big idea that very few people really embrace and push forward. It doesn't have to be about better, lighter, brighter, faster, 40% more, 20% off. You can actually engage with people. And the amazing thing about this engagement is that when the next person comes along, that knowledge isn't lost or gone. That knowledge is there, it's live, it's active, and it's there for the person. So even if they had a concern or an issue and the brands responded to it, that's there for the next person who might have a similar issue to it. The challenge is it actually forces us to think dramatically different about how we And how we do things is an important part of this, because fundamentally the way advertising and marketing always works was off of, as you see on the left, the number sign, how many. And the idea was simply this. What you would do is you would go and say, okay, we've got 10 million people seeing this ad, and based off of that, we're hoping for a 2 or 3 or 5% conversion. That's really what we're looking for. And if we can just get those people to convert, that's our nut. That's what we're looking to accomplish. Fantastic. What we're not saying is, you know, 97 or 95% of the ad was annoying to the rest of the people, had no effect on them, or didn't really resonate with them. I believe that these online channels actually don't embrace or encourage the mass model. I believe that these channels, and specifically social media for sure, embrace the idea of who. And here's what I mean by that. I could put up billboards all over the place telling people to buy a 6 pixels of separation of book and available now at all retail and stuff like that. Or I can go online and really identify, because those people are coming forward and raising their hands and saying, who here is interested in business books, marketing books, new media books? And I believe, and I think you believe this too if you're on this call, that within that who, you find your masses. And so it's not a question of shifting from waste to more targeted and strategic. It's a mind shift where you have to know that sometimes if the engagement is only going to hit 2,000 people, that would be a really good nut in that sense for you to have as a company. One of the more interesting things I've done over the years is I've been back and forth to Google many times, doing a couple of events for them. It's always a pleasure to go out there. They're such great people. And if you've never been to a Googleplex, that in and of itself is a great trip and something that I highly recommend you do. And at one of my first events, I was actually sharing, I was doing a closing keynote for a big retail event they were holding at the Googleplex. And the opening keynote was the chief information officer at the time. And since I've been back to a couple times, in fact, I was just there last month, and they tell me that this statistic is still very valid. It's mind-blowing to me. I don't know if you know this or not, but every single day, 20% of all the searches done in Google are searches that have never been done in the engine before. That's unbelievable to think about. 20% of all searches done on Google every single day are searches that have never been done in the engine before. And so when Jeff Jarvis writes this great book, What Would Google Do?, and I think it's an amazing book, you know, my whole answer back is all businesses need to be smarter. I mean, if we live in a, I mean, imagine I came to you and said, your business is going to change 20% next year and you don't know where it's going to be from. You'd be like, you know, past the Xanax pretty much. You'd be like, where are the tranquilizers? If I told you it was going to change every month, every week, I mean, every week, if someone came to me and said, my business, I won't know 20% of my business is going to come from every week, I would be requesting the same stuff that probably killed Michael Jackson. Like, I really need to be sedated in a major, major way. And so the point of this really is you really need to be more malleable as a business. You need to be more flexible. If they can turn those record profits, being who they are, and not understanding where 20% of their inventory is or coming from, I think all of us could be a little better at it as well. You look at YouTube, and you get this all the time where people are, you know, YouTube online videos. I mean, half of their audience is over the age of 34. Unbelievable. You know, here we all thought it was a bunch of 12-year-old kids, you know, smashing each other in the heads with hockey sticks to a bunch of other 12-year-old kids. And it turns out it's us who's watching those 12-year-old kids getting smacked in the heads with hockey sticks. So, unbelievable. And again, if you think about it, who here hasn't watched a video on YouTube in the past month or so? I don't know what the stats are like in the U.S., but I know they're fairly similar to Canada. In Canada, the average Canadian is watching about 10 hours of online video every single month. And it's not a lot when you compare it to TV usage, specifically if you compare it to U.S. TV usage, but man, that's a lot of time if you really think about the fact that, you know, 2 years ago we had buffering issues here. It was annoying enough. And it's amazing, too, like on a 2x2 low-def screen. I mean, we've got HD now on YouTube, but still, amazing, 10 hours plus of video online. The other interesting aspect is this. I don't know many people who are still on dial-up, and I know that there's definitely a whole bunch of more rural areas and challenged areas in both the U.S. and Canada that have to deal with this, but pretty much most people that I'm dealing with are online and have broadband access, and most of the people who are target demographics when it comes to marketing communications fall in that lot as well. Think about that. Half of your time, your leisure time, is spent online. And I get people all the time like, it's impossible, right? Like, take the kids to soccer, doing all this stuff. Sure, maybe, fine, great. But at the end of the day, the end of it all, what's really happening here is people are connected. and they're not connected just by going online and logging on. It's a Sunday afternoon. We're at brunch, and I turn to them and I say, what time does Borders open? And you whip open your iPhone, your BlackBerry, whatever it is, and you tell me, we're all connected. We're all online all the time. One of the things I've been pushing a lot lately is maybe we need to stop benchmarking the Internet against TV usage and start benchmarking against electricity. I mean, this is the reality of the new world. And so I wrote this book, and yes, this is a cover shot, and this is not me pimping the book at all, but this is me trying to explain to you the idea behind the book, because the blog came before the book, and before the blog came this concept. 6 degrees of separation, small world theory, the idea that any one of us is connected to anyone else who's less than 6 degrees. The idea here is that I know someone who knows someone who knows someone who knows you, and they can make us introduced if we so choose. They tested this theory constantly and consistently over time. More recently, there was a documentary out of Australia called How Kevin Bacon is Going to Cure Cancer. And the idea here is that you probably know the story of 6 degrees of Kevin Bacon, where if you enter any actor who's ever been in anything into this database, it'll tell you in less than 6 degrees how closely they've been in some sort of movie with Kevin Bacon. And so the idea here was that they were going to pass out 200 packages all over the world, and could these people who got these packages return them back to a Dana-Farber cancer researcher in Massachusetts, Boston, Massachusetts, in less than 6 degrees? There are two rules to this game in this documentary. Rule number one was that you had to know the person by first name. So you couldn't run over to the airport and sort of go and look for who's going to Boston and pass it to someone who's, by the way, Capri doesn't like it if you want to try that, so don't try that. You actually have to know the person by first name. So I'd have to say, Mike, do you know anybody who is in New York or Boston or whatever that you might be able to share this with? And he would say, yes, I do, or I don't, etc., etc. Rule number two is even more fascinating, which is you can't use the Internet. That's crazy. Why? Well, because if you go into Bing or Yahoo or Google and do a search for this guy, the first result is his profile from the Dana-Farber Cancer Research Institute. It's his bio, it's his email, it's his fax, it's his phone number, it's his instant message, it's his Facebook profile, it's a link to his blog, and it's all there. And that's the big idea here. It's not that it's a clever title. We no longer live in a world where we're degrees separated. We're all intrinsically connected. And again, that changes the way we communicate, connect, and market to one another in a huge and dramatic way. I love Clay Shirky's book, Here Comes Everybody, and in it he talks about the advent of the Gutenberg Press and how a lot of people in business align that moment with the Industrial Revolution. That's where the things got all kicked off for all of us in terms of companies and groups and stuff like that. But what Clay says is actually this is a more unique moment in time, where suddenly, because of the Gutenberg Press, one individual has the ability to express themselves to the world. What a beautiful thought when you think about it. And that was a big thing. Before the Gutenberg Press, you couldn't really do that. You could only express yourself to a group as loud as you could talk. Suddenly, ideas were spreading. As you fast forward many, many, many years, we come to the idea of telecommunications, where suddenly we have this two-way expression. And if you stop the world right there, you would think that actually all advertising and marketing and communications is based on that model, either a one-way or a two-way. In fact, many people argue that the Internet is the ultimate one-to-one channel. Shirky argues that he sort of brings the conversation to another level where he says that we're now entering into a new conversation. And this conversation is what he defines as a group expression. And I really love this if you think about it. The group expression, the fact that people can get together and share with equal volumes of voice regardless of demographics, regardless of geography, and that they can, big groups, small groups, they can talk, they can share, and then they can disband as needed. And it's so interesting if you think about the web, because it's really what it is right now. And so why is it that marketers think we can use a one-way or a two-way advertising traditional mechanism in this type of channel? And the answer is we can't. And so the question becomes, what can we do? And the answer to that is, we don't know. And that's part of the challenge. We're in the middle of it. And I really do think we are in a renaissance period, and we can't even tell that we're in a renaissance period until after it's over. And so we just have to sort of be able to work together, try new things, work with people like Awareness, people like Mike, people like Chris Brogan, all these sorts of people who are really thinking differently about how people can connect when everybody has this type of availability. And so what happens is a lot of new media people jump to this idea that we're no longer in control and that that's what we're going to sell to brands to make them nervous to hire us. You're not in control of your brand anymore. You better start doing some of this crazy social media stuff. I simply don't believe that to be true. One of the ideas I talk a lot about in the book, and I'll share with you guys right here today, is the idea of no control. Understanding what control is in this day and age. And that's a really different perspective. And the idea really here is that consumer brand, you still control your products and services. You still control your pricing. You still control your distribution, your advertising, your marketing. You still control aftercare. Consumers still control what they've always controlled, whether or not they're going to buy from you and then whether or not they're going to spread the idea. So what has changed? Well, essentially what has changed is suddenly consumers have volume. Their voice can be heard as equally as the brand's voice. Traditionally, that could never happen, right? You're pissed off at a company, you write a letter, someone sends you a coupon, files that letter in their desk and hope no one ever sees that letter again. Now there's this living organism online of this trail of content that's there. And really what's happening is not a lack of control, but an input of audio volume, like literally audible volume you can actually hear now. And that scares people, and if you've seen the movie Spinal Tap, it goes to 11, right? This is very, very loud. And so what happens in a world of marketing communications where all voices are equal? And I believe that that is a fundamental challenge that we all have as marketers today. How do we connect with consumers when we can't scream loud at them, but when we talk with them and have them be part of that group? And Chris Anderson, who's, as you probably know, is the editor of Wired Magazine and author of The Long Tail, he's got a brand new book out called Free, which is also great, says, your brand isn't what you say it is, it's what Google says it is. And I mean, how true is that if you think about it? If I told you about this great new laptop, do you run down to Best Buy, or do you hop onto Google, do a search, and that's the result? Like the first page of search result is the brand, positive, negative, or neutral, that's the experience. And it's amazing how so few people, so few marketers, spend time really understanding that as the core philosophy. One of my most favorite people and close friends is Avinash Kaushik. Avinash is the analytics evangelist at Google. He wrote the book Web Analytics an Hour a Day, and he's got a new book coming out actually called Web Analytics 2.0. It's amazing. Well worth checking out. And I was telling Avinash a story, and he's like, you know, Mitch, at the end of the day, you don't control your homepage. Google does. And I thought, leave it to a Google employee to be that sort of, you know, just high on themselves. But, yeah, at the time, Avinash was still a consultant there. He wasn't a full-time employee. But his point is well taken. And the point is that people no longer really navigate through sites the way they traditionally had. And I think companies still think that. And what happens is we all go on, you know, let's say you want to buy a, you know, Revlon red lipstick. You hop onto your favorite search engine, you do a search, you know, Revlon red lipstick. You don't go to Lord & Taylor, choose female, cosmetics, you know, sorry, beauty, cosmetics, makeup, lipstick, going down to sort of navigate. You don't do that, right? You go to your search engine, you type in Revlon red lipstick, Lord & Taylor, enter. That first page of search result comes up. That first result, first of all, better be exactly what I'm looking for. People click on that. They go to the site. It's not right. They leave. This is called the bounce rate. Right? One of the sort of more newer and interesting metrics we use in the online channel. The bounce rate is someone who's come onto a site, didn't do anything, didn't click on anything, and left without giving a click. Whereas Avinash likes to explain that I came, I puked, and I left. Now, this is crazy if you think about it, that you've gone this far and you can't even convert them to make them a valuable customer, or at least get them to choose something else if it's confusing or wrong. And I think that fundamentally speaks to the ways in which we have to think differently about how we build websites, where literally every page now becomes your homepage. And I think it's an important idea that not too many people talk about. There's this other notion where you sit down with a lot of marketers and you say, like, why is that? Like, why are you not embracing this new media channel, or why are you doing it so tactfully? And the answer is usually, well, you know, it's just the way it's always been. I don't believe that to be true if you actually do any studying on the history of mass media. I mean, it's been around for a long time for sure, but it's really been in our vernacular, the word mass media, for about 80 or 90 years. And although that's a long time, it's not all the time. And for many, many years, a lot longer than 80 years, people were telling each other stories, people were using word of mouth, and suddenly we have this platform where you can do all that in a much bigger way, and all those voices become equalized. And so if that's the sort of answer people give you, well, it's the way it's always been, I don't believe that to be true at all. And I'll end by being semi-provocative here. It's crazy. I mean, you know, if you're on the phone again, I think you're sort of already drinking the Kool-Aid a little bit, but this is really, really crazy. I've had some blog posts recently where I've been talking about how marketers are just fundamentally irresponsible. I believe in the power of branding. I believe in the power of traditional media. But the notion of, let's say, billboards is an example where you're hoping that millions of people will see this billboard and then react to it at some point later. Very, very valuable, and obviously if it didn't work, no one would do it. But there's this other world, and it's called search, and it's called the web, where, you know, we've been talking for about 40 minutes here. How many thousands of Americans do you think are online in this short while looking for whatever it is you sell? Now, they might not be looking specifically for your product or service, but they're looking for a solution to a problem. You sell nail polish, and someone's out there right now saying, you know, trying to figure out what color I should wear on my nails tonight. They're not really looking for your brand specifically, but they're looking for you if you have something that can fulfill their needs. And so I've been on this sort of kick lately where I believe 100% of your budget should go digital, specifically search in that area. And whatever's left over, whatever you can't monetize, if people are already raising their hands, you know, go ahead, do all the branding you want, all of that stuff. It's all good. It all works. It's all reasonable. But when, if we're in a recession, I don't know. They keep telling us we're in a recession. We're out of recession. Who knows? The idea that there are people raising their hand and we're not there and we're still doing billboards and stuff like that, I think is crazy. It makes me crazy in general. And so people say, well, you know what, Mitch, we hear what you're saying, and, you know, we're drinking the Kool-Aid, and we agree with you, but we are evolved. We have a blog, and we have Twitter, but, you know, and stuff, nothing's really happening. I think that there's a couple things that are happening that you're just not really fundamentally aware of, and one of them is a lot of times when people jump on the latest tool, Twitter, Facebook, whatever, they do it because it's the shiny object. They think everyone's there, and there's no strategy, and so they're talking about what they're doing on Twitter versus why they're on Twitter. And why, I think, is a bigger question to ask. Not what are we doing on Twitter, what are we doing on YouTube, but why? Why should we be on Twitter, why should we be on YouTube? When you can ask the why, you can really tie into that ROI and that strategy and figure out your tactics after. What I'm here to say is once you find your why and you start using some of these channels, there's another sort of way to think about it as well, which is it's not so much about what you do, but what your community does with it. So if you take my blog, for example, which is does really, really well. It doesn't do well because I'm blogging. It does well because people leave comments and share it and talk about it on Twitter and share things on Facebook. And if it's just me doing it because it's a blog and it's a new thing, it's nothing more than textual masturbation, right? It's all it is. But what makes it interesting, what makes it evolve, is the community. And how do you evolve communities? You give them tools and platforms and valuable things that are valuable to them that they can share, that they can connect to one another and they can connect to themselves. I'm going to really quickly rock you through my 6 points of separation. I was going to say walk, but I did mean rock. I do my podcast, 6 Pixels of Separation. I do this a lot on my blog, where it's just sort of 6 things that you can do right now. One really is acceptance. I mean, it still is a bee in my bonnet when I go to companies and they're blocking their marketing department from Facebook and YouTube. It's like, you know, pretend it doesn't exist. Stop wasting your time. Because, you know, if we block you from Facebook and YouTube, that will really stop you from wasting your time. You won't find something else to do, like take up smoking or just leave early, right? Crazy at me, but accept it. Yeah, these conversations are happening. They're there. They're active. Are you going to be a part of it, or are you not? Two is, it's not about just digital. One of my favorite sayings is, everything is with, not instead of. And what I mean by that is, a lot of times when we go in to compete on business with other agencies, these agencies walk in and tell their clients, the potential clients rather, listen, you got to stop doing all this traditional stuff and start embracing the idea of blogs and podcasts. And that's simply not the case. Brands are doing amazing things with traditional media and even traditional online media. I think there's a way to add and augment to it, and then you can figure out the temperature and how well you can do it as it goes on, but it's not one or the other. My next point is, I believe because of these channels and how social they are, that every interaction you have is an opportunity to build, share, and grow. And that's definitely around the idea of community. I don't understand why you would just blast a message with an action in front of it when you have an opportunity to get something back too, whether it's insight, data, whatever it might be. And so don't forget that either. It's a great opportunity. My next point would be just to sort of start thinking more candidly about opening more. Opening means internally, share your documents on a wiki internally. Let people add comments and edit stuff. Open up more in general. I mean, I think the more open brands are, the more wins they have long term. There are always exceptions to this rule, but in general, I think that we are moving towards a more open society. My next point is that it's more about your attitude and less about your age. A lot of times when I speak to very different groups, you got an older segment in the audience, and you can see their body language is screaming, I can hardly figure out my email. You want me to understand Facebook? And again, it's not about your age. It's about your attitude. I know many businesses who have very senior people in those companies who are embracing these channels and really pushing things to the next level for them. And my last point would be to do something. I think that's, you know, it runs a bit contrary to the idea of the strategy, but the idea here is that this isn't like the flashing 12 on a VCR where you might break it if you do it. The idea here is simply you can do things, you should try things, but you should really be there pushing the ideas out there and doing things and going forward and just, you know, in general, getting very, very excited about it. So big on that, very excited about that. We spent about an hour. I'm going to turn it back to Mike in a little bit, but before I do, just remember that the reason people engage in these channels more and more every day is not because of the technology behind it. And I think our jobs, I think the guys at Awareness do a great job of this too, is they make the technology invisible to the consumer. The consumer doesn't care about the technology behind it. They really don't. They want it to be simple, easy, and good when they use it. And so whenever I get asked, like, why is Facebook so popular, why is Twitter so popular, to me it's obvious. Facebook is so popular because it's way easier to use than Facebook, than MySpace was, or than Friendster was, and also just, you know, the connectivity, there's a whole bunch. It's not just the platform. It's just, it's easier, there's more people, et cetera. So Twitter, too. Twitter is so easy. Because, you know, blogging is, you know, finish something, write something, publish something. Here, 140 characters, anyone can get it out and push it out there. And so remember that that's an important part of this, too. Your job is to really connect it to consumers and make them smarter. And my last point would simply be, again, forget the technology. Your consumers are online, whether they know it or not, or whether you know it or not. They're there, and they're connecting, and they're sharing. And the question really becomes for brands, are you there? And if you are there, hopefully you're successful at it. And if you're there and it's not working for you, hopefully you can figure out ways to make it that much more successful. I'm very easy to find. All you have to do is enter Mitch Joel into this little engine, and you can find my cell phone number, my email address, I guess, my blog, my podcast, Twitter. And I do this so that you can really figure out how you want to connect to me and that you'll stay connected. This is an awkward thing because I'm just sort of screaming into a phone. I prefer the back and forth, and I prefer being connected. So feel free to add me on Twitter. Feel free to add me on Facebook. And I'd like to extend the conversation. Thank you for encouraging my behavior and lending your attention and time. I'll pass it back to Mike. I don't know if we'll take questions or how you want to work this, but over to you.
Hey, Mitch. Well, that was awesome. Yeah, we got a ton of questions that came in. I think we'll probably take 5 or 10 minutes, and then, you know, what we'll do for everybody that we can't get to, because there's just so many of them, and, you know, we're right at 3 o'clock, so, you know, what we'll probably do is just we'll take them down and we'll do our best to get back to them for everybody that, you know, we can't get back to on the call. Real quickly for just everybody, before I jump into the Q&A part of everything, I'm not going to pull up any slides. I just wanted to let you all know that we have some other pretty cool webinars coming up in the next 4 weeks. We have Scott Montes, who's the head of social media for it. If you don't know Scott, it's going to be a great session. I'm really excited about having him on. He's going to be with us on November 4th. And then we have Rachel Happy and Jim Storer from the Community Roundtable. If you don't know them, they're an organization devoted to helping community managers get the most out of the communities that they're running. They're going to be coming on November 19th, which I'm excited about too. So you can check it out on our website, awarenessnetworks.com, or ping me on Twitter. I'm Boston Mike on Twitter. Feel free to just shoot me a DM, and I'll get back to you with any details that you want. So Mitch, just real quick on some of the questions, I'm going to take some of the what I thought were the best ones, and so I apologize to everybody on Twitter if something come up as one of the ones I thought was the best. But one of the most profound ones is you talk to a bunch of the stuff that's going on, and kind of the, you know, that we're in a renaissance period, and just some really cool stuff. What's next for social media and marketing in general? How do you see this stuff evolving in the next, you know, I don't even know how many years, but how do you see this evolving in the future?
I think, you know, one of the, it's funny, when I wrote the book, I sort of avoided that question entirely, and my editor came back to me and said, you know, why don't you put a couple of trends in the end? I was like, oh, I sort of sighed, because it really is what I said at the beginning, where it's like, the world now I find so different and a little bit confusing but exciting at the same time. One of the things that definitely I sort of got my eye on is more focused social networks, ones that are very much driven by a lot of permission and very much driven by a specific niche. I think we're in the middle of this shiny object syndrome where it's like everybody's on this, so everybody jump on. But what I think will happen after a while is there will be a little bit of fatigue there, and we'll move more towards networks that are very, very close. And if you think about the idea I talked about earlier about, you know, shifting from how many to who, you can almost see that transitioning into this new channel as well, where we'll see more and more people, you know, involved in 4 or 5 social networks, but those social networks evolve around, you know, 50 or 5 to 200 people max.
So one of the other points that you brought up, and there were a couple of people that chatted about this, and it was around, it was really specific around getting management buy-in to do more social type of stuff. And I just came from a client last week, and you'll appreciate this story. They're a B2B company, just getting started in social media. I had done my homework before I went in and actually brought up their LinkedIn group. And when I brought up their LinkedIn group, they said, you know, well, it's not company sponsored. In fact, everybody that's used our logo on that group, we're getting a cease and desist order for. Believe it or not, that's a true story. I won't mention the name of the company, Protect the Innocent. But how do you get management, that people that have kind of a traditional view of marketing, I won't say old school, but a traditional view of marketing, to buy in to the way things are going?
It's one of those things where, I mean, there's a couple things. One is I think the strategy component is sorely missing from digital agencies. And I think that that's a core thing where if you can really get a strategic mandate in front of these people and understanding that this is not tied into some, you know, conversation, it's actually tied into the ROI of the business and the imperative moving forward, that's a great way. That's not always easy to do. One of the ways that you can sort of carrot them along to there is simply by doing some basic searches, and you can do this in places like Twitter search or even Google now, gives you the option to look in the past 24 hours, you can look by blogs and stuff like that. Just show them a bit of a conversation, not, you know, for sure around the brand and then senior managers and people like that, if you've got people who are in the media, but around the industry. And I'll give you an example of sort of one of the ways this has worked for me where I was impressed is I'm represented in the U.S. by a speaking bureau. And they came to me with an event and a gig. I thought, this is so great, cool. And I asked, you know, where did this come from? And they're like, basically they're on Twitter, but they're not really on Twitter. They're just listening. And so one of the keywords they're searching for using TweetDeck is keynote speaker. And when they saw someone looking for a keynote speaker in the digital space and they had someone, namely me, they recommended me. And I thought, you know, how amazing would that be to show management, like just look how many people are talking about the products and services that we actually can help them with right now online. And just a list like that is usually staggering because, again, you know, if you think about being recessionary times and people stuck, it's like, you're all just potential customers, interested, not your call. It's pretty basic.
Man, well, one last question, and because I'm trying to summarize a bunch of the questions that came in, and I'm sure you get this in every session that you give, but there's a lot of questions about ROI. We have some asking, you know, how do you measure your reputation? How do you measure connections? And I think it kind of boils down to the big, you know, the 800-pound gorilla in the room, which is the ROI question. Do you have any recommendations for people that are just getting started in social media, or maybe even, you know, up and running on social media? How do you really measure an ROI to be able to present back to either management or to show how successful what it is, you know, that you're doing is?
Well, it's a big question, and the reason it's a big question is because I think when it comes to the social channels, the ROI is dependent on what the strategy is. And so in the world of traditional mass media, which is, again, not burning the ships, not control all deleting this, we look at the impressions, clicks, conversions, versus the social space where it might be things like engagement or questions around our brand or how many brand evangelists were we able to create or initiate and go through. And so it really does lie more on that side. And one of the ways I think is a good way to sort of test it so you can push the idea that there's an ROI here is to bring it internal. And so, you know, immediate recommendations would be things like trying out like a corporate wiki internally, corporate blogging, even though it's a little podcast, go over, interview the CEO, show the people, if you imagine, like, look at the adoption within our community, look at how much more open it made people, look how much more loyal it's made our employees, and they're actually our best, you know, your best brand evangelists walk out the door at 5 p.m. every day. And so it's a, you know, for me, the ROI, if you can actually show them in terms of how they've optimized your own business by using these tools is a great way to do it. But, you know, I really do think it's a blend of things like, you know, more modern web analytics and usage. I mean, you know, the ROI you're going to get out of Twitter is going to be very different than the ROI you're going to pull out of a blog, even though they're both text. And so it really does depend on what you're trying to do. You know, if I were to take a personal story, the ROI for me on my blog is really simple. You know, thousands and thousands of people reading it every single day, great. At the end of the year, if I get 6 new clients, 2 marketing officers to read my blog and engage with them as a digital marketing agency record, that's more business than I can handle. And so it's amazing that my ROI is really 6 key people in the end. And, you know, yeah, we do all of this work for them, but that's what my ROI is.
Great. Well, Mitch, you know, I really appreciate you taking some time, and if you haven't been following it the whole time, the conversation on Twitter has just been terrific, and nothing but great feedback, as always, and I really just appreciate you taking some time, and hopefully you can join us again sometime soon.
I really appreciate you taking the initiative to do this, Mike, and thanks to you, and thanks to everybody who's listening, and if you ever want to reach me, it's mitch@twistimage.com, or @MitchJoel, or facebook.com/MitchJoel.
Great, and thanks again, and thanks everybody on the line, and we'll talk to you all soon. Appreciate it.